Well, it's a real privilege to be with you. I'm impressed that there are this many people in the room in the middle of a school week. I was trying to think back of my college days. I would have been here. I probably wouldn't have been studying either. So that says something about me. Let me just begin with a word of prayer. Lord, we are very, very thankful that we don't have to be afraid of the hard issues of everyday life, because we have been, by grace, connected to the one who is wisdom. What a comfort that is to us. And we don't have to pretend that we don't have questions or we don't have struggle, because you are one of amazing, forgiving, rescuing, transforming grace. It is your wisdom and your grace that gives us hope this evening. Thank you that you are with us. We pray that you would give us eyes that are open and ears that are open and hearts that are willing to receive what you have for us. In Jesus' name, amen. I was thinking about the assignment that I have with you, and I don't know where you are in this topic. What was the title? Finding Sexual Sanity in a World Gone Crazy. In the church, this has been tended to be a topic that no one wants to talk about. While the culture talks constantly about sex, the Church of Jesus Christ has tended to be strangely silent, strangely embarrassed to have the conversation. That's one side. The other side is people who just want these two questions answered. What can I do, and how far can I go? They're not actually interested in talking about sex any more than the people who are afraid to talk about the topic. So I'm impressed that you're here. I was wondering if anybody would really want to have this conversation. And here's the way I would like to begin this evening. I would like you to reflect on the fact that in the area of sexuality, we're in the middle of a culture that's just gone insane. We are insane. We are crazy. We have gone crazy. And you don't have to look very far to see the craziness of our culture. It's just everywhere around us. When my kids were still home, I was at Old Navy buying khakis for my son. He was about 13. Now you know, this is not a radical store. Old Navy is anything but radical. If you're into radical clothing, you're not shopping at Old Navy. This is khaki and polo country, right? Old Navy. And I look across the aisle from where we're standing, and there's a little girl's department. There's a rack there that says 5'6", so these are real little girls. And they're hanging on the rack are these outfits that are these micro mini skirts and halter tops. For five-year-old girls. You should be reacting at this point. Five-year-old girls. I was immediately... Thank you. I was immediately in a rage. I wanted to tear down the rack. Fortunately, I had my 13-year-old son with me who kept saying, "Dad, you're not going to do something, are you?" Because he'd been shopping with me before. My daughter is, she's about 6'1", she's slim, she was a bit of a late developer, and she's in her senior year of high school. At Christmas, she gets this surprise gift from one of her friends. It came in the mail. It's sort of exciting. And I was in the other room. She tore open the package, and I heard her gasp. And I went into the dining room. There, sitting on the dining room table, was this weird back of a woman's magazine breast development kit. Yeah, you heard what I said. This is her friend from her Christian school. And she said to me, "Dad, how weird is it that my friend would decide to buy me a gift and the only thing she could think is, poor Nicole, her breasts are too small." That's a culture that's gone crazy. I mean, it's quite regular now for us to put knives to the chests of our women and put in plasticine substances so they have bigger breasts, so they have a more obvious sexual appearance. The tribes that used to stretch the ears, stretch the neck, bind the feet, we would have called primitive. We're just as primitive. We've gone crazy. In major cities across the United States, high schools are putting a daycare center next to the high school because there are so many young women in high school who are in care of young children that they have to provide something for those young children. We're crazy. We're just crazy. The amount of young high school children who are having oral sex regularly in America is itself a scandal. And many of them, when interviewed, say the reason they're having oral sex is because it's not really sex. Sort of is to me. We're crazy. I was thinking about this topic, and yesterday, Monday, my wife Luella and I spend the day together, and we decide in the afternoon to go to a film. It was one of those more sort of art house film places where you find the film that you're never in the crowd more than 12 people watching the film. And there is this card. It's advertising the Erotic Literary Salon. I don't even know what that is. Steamy, hot words to fire up the evening, I guess. Now, I'm sure you'll never have this at Wheaton. Erotic open mic. I don't know what that is. It's followed by special performances. And I guess if you have erotic open mic and special performances, you would also have this third thing, lively discussions. We're nuts. We've gone crazy. I mean, think. We laugh, but think of the harvest of brokenness that comes out of this. Think of the amount of children that are born by people who don't want children. They don't want children. I live right in the city. I've stood in stores and watched a young mother unprepared to be a mother brutalizing her child. I want to grab the child and run. Imagine the political careers that have been destroyed by illicit sexuality. Imagine the harvest of pain of families that have been destroyed by the sexual insanity. Imagine how our entertainment and leisure and media industries have been just totally distorted and corrupted by sex. Imagine that probably the most powerful economic driver of the internet is pornography. A multi-billion dollar, multinational pornographic industry. If you don't know who I'm talking about, Google. Google knows exactly what it's doing. Google wouldn't exist without pornography. because it drives the engine. We're crazy. We're crazy. It can't work. It's not working. And so we don't actually have the liberty to be silent. We don't have the liberty to be embarrassed. We don't have the liberty to hope somehow we'll be prepared for the world that we live in. Because there's two things that collide in your life, and you have to face these. First, that you are, by God's design, a sexual being. You can't escape it. God's wired you, He's hardwired you to be a sexual being. It's an inescapable part of your life. And you will express your sexuality somehow, some way. You'll have sexual thoughts, you'll have sexual interests, you'll have sexual desire. You'll formulate some kind of personal sexual worldview. Everybody does it. Everybody in this room is interested in sex. Everybody in this room is greeted by sexual desire. Everybody in this room at moments will wonder about their own sexuality and what this whole thing is about, and where do I fit and how do I participate in all those big questions. So the sexual part of your nature every day somehow collides with the insanity of your culture. The reason you're susceptible to the insanity of your culture is because you're a sexual being. And it's not like this thing is of no interest to you. It's not like it's not part of your identity. And so we just do not have the liberty, I guess this is a double negative, to not talk about this. We have to talk about this. I think we've been too quiet. I think we've been too embarrassed. I think we've been too reticent. And so if you think about it, the evangelical church of Jesus Christ is not part of the cultural conversation. We're not part of it because we've dealt away our influence in strange, embarrassed silence. And so I'm heartened by an evening like this because I think this is what we need to be doing. We need to have wholesome conversations about this area that is right now a clear area of cultural insanity. My next book coming out in April, this is not meant to be an advertisement, is called Sex and Money. Pleasures that leave you empty and grace that satisfies. Because I think one place clearly where Western culture has gone insane is in those two areas, sex and money. Now here's where I want to begin with you. This is a rhetorical question. You don't have to answer it aloud. It's for the purpose of stimulating your thought. If someone asks you, what are the four most important words that have ever been said about sex, what would you write down? Not what can I do, for those of you who are thinking, that's got to be it. What would you write? What are the four most important words that you could encounter, that you could think about, that are the only way to begin to move away from the insanity of the surrounding culture? What would they be? I would bet that I don't know how many people are in this room, but I would bet that no one's thinking the four words that I'm thinking. And there's a reason for that. You're going to have to give me a chance to connect this for you. But here they are. Here's the four most important words ever spoken about sex. In the beginning, God. Because if you don't start there, if you don't start with this single radical recognition that you and I are born into a world that's under rule. You're born into a world of authority. It's the inescapable bottom line perspective of any thoughtful Christian. That this is not an open world. This is a world under rule. There is one who made this world, who has the right to exercise authority, the power to exercise authority, the right to tell us what to do. You cannot have this conversation any other way. Because once you have the sexual conversation in isolation, apart from this one escapable reality, there's no way to answer the questions. There's no way. Because what right would I ever have to say to you anything of any moral imperative? I would have none. I have no right to say anything to anybody about their sexual life. None. You do whatever you want to do. You find whatever pathway you want to find. You find whatever pleasure you want to find. You do whatever you want to do because there is no thing more ultimate than you. The whole thing just completely falls apart. That happens to be where our culture is. You don't have any right to say anything to me about this issue. None. And when you do, I think you're some alien from another planet. What right do you have? I believe that the ultimate fact of facts of the human existence is the existence, the character, and the plan of God. You can't understand anything properly unless you look at it from the vantage point of the existence, the character, and the plan of God. God is the ultimate fact that gives substance and meaning and interpretation and explanation and understanding to every other fact that exists. The great Christian thinker John Calvin said, "There is no knowing that doesn't begin with knowing God." Now, there are two lies that I think in some way every human being wants to buy into, and they really do fit into our conversation. Here's the first one. It's the lie of autonomy. I want to believe that I'm an independent human being, that my life belongs to me, and I have the right to do with my life whatever I want to do. That's a very seductive lie. I would like to believe that. And you know that every child ever born believes that. I never had my children say to me, "Dad, if you could just command me more, if you just give me more rules, I would feel so secure." Never said that. They would fight for their independence at the lowest level. "You will not make me eat these peas. Try it." And their teeth would be like a vice. They want to retain whatever piece of autonomy they could retain. We tell them what time to go to bed, but they do anything in bed not to go to sleep. "You can make me go to bed, but you can't make me go to sleep." "I'll prop open my eyes until they're bloodshot." I want to believe that my life belongs to me, that I can do anything with my mind, my heart, my physical body that pleases me. And if there is a God, and if He is creator, then there's no such thing as autonomy. My mentality doesn't belong to me. My personality doesn't belong to me. My psychology doesn't belong to me. My physicality doesn't belong to me. My emotionality doesn't belong to me. My relationships don't belong to me. I'm a creature of someone. And by the very nature of that, I'm not autonomous. The second lie is the lie of self-sufficiency. And what that says is, I have everything I need inside of myself to be what I'm supposed to be and to do what I'm supposed to do. I don't need your help, thank you. I have all the internal wisdom that I need to figure life out. Or I have all the internal wisdom I need to figure sexuality out. I don't need your help, thank you. And I can be what I should be in this area without assistance. Again, as a parent, I encounter that with my children. At some young age, one of my children would realize that their shoes have laces, and they would decide that they want to learn how to tie laces. Well, they don't really want to learn. They just want to tie them. And so they'd be fumbling with their laces. Now, they had no idea how to make a bow. They could fumble with those laces for the next century and not get a bow. But I'd reach down to help them, and guess what they would do? They would slap my hand away. Because they want to buy into the delusion that they're able to matriculate through life to make small to huge decisions without any help. And so if you buy into your autonomy, you will say, no one has the right to tell me how to do anything with my body. If you buy into self-sufficiency, you will impart yourself a level of capability that you don't actually have. No wonder we've reached the insanity that we've reached. Because we're actually telling ourselves that we're people that we're not. And we're telling ourselves that we're capable of things that we're not. And that never goes anywhere good. I say this all the time, and people tend to laugh when I say it. I think I say it almost every time I speak anywhere, but I'll say it tonight. No one is more influential in your life than you are, because no one talks to you more than you do. A couple of you laughed. It was sort of a weak laugh. Now, you are in a constant conversation with yourself. You never stop talking to you. Most of us have learned it's best not to move our lips because they'll think we're crazy, and definitely don't change places because they'll quickly put you away. But if I were to listen to the conversation that you're having with you, what would I hear? What identity are you assigning to yourself? What capabilities are you assigning to yourself? What are you saying to yourself about areas like this area of sexuality? Sex. What is the character and quality of your private conversation? Are you telling yourself you have more autonomy than you actually have? Are you telling yourself that you have more capability than you actually have? Or are you again and again telling yourself that you were created to be dependent? That you weren't created with the independent ability to figure it all out on your own, that you just don't have that ability. What are you saying to you? Well, a little bit closer to this whole issue that we're here to talk about. If you don't start with those four words, in the beginning God, then what you're left with in your sexual life is what I call small picture sex. It's sex isolated. It's sex isolated from the major, huge issues of everyday life. It's sex detached from everything else. It's trying to have a conversation about sex that's only about sex and doesn't look to answer sexual questions by going anywhere else. You're just left with, all we can talk about is sex, but we can't talk about sex in context. We can't talk about sex in bigger issues. I mean, if you're on the street and someone wants to discuss sex with you, or you're getting some conversation with somebody who's got some questions, and you begin to talk about larger theological issues, they think you've changed the subject. They're not interested. But I would propose to you that's the only way to have the conversation. So if you're cut off from those things, not only now are you left to talk about sex in isolation, but you end up with what I call the individualization of sex. The individualization of sex. That's, sex is just about me. Let me give you the steps. First of all, it means I own my sexual life. It's about me. Sex, my sexual life, doesn't have boundaries, doesn't have concerns, doesn't have imperatives any bigger than my wants, my needs, my feelings. It's sex shrunk down to the claustrophobic confines of my little, I want, I feel, I need. If you're there, then the thing you're interested in is just pleasure. What's the best pathway for me, the most comfortable pathway for me to pleasure? How can I get pleasure out of this thing? Because I don't carry anything bigger than that. There's nothing more ultimate in my sexual life than me. I'm the biggest thing in my sexual life. I'm the thing that I care about in my sexual life. It's only me. It's a fundamentally meistic way of thinking about something like sex. It's me in the center of my world. It's me as ultimate, my wants, my needs, my feelings. It's totally my pleasure driven. And I want to make an aside that you can ask questions about later. But if in the area of sex, the only thing that motivates you is your pleasure, you're a dangerous person. By the very nature of that, you're a dangerous person. Because what will happen then is, because I pursue this area with no higher goal than my own fulfillment, my own pleasure, my own contentment, by the very nature of that, I will use you to get the pleasure that I want. Because my biggest commitment is not to you. My biggest commitment is not to things that are way bigger than both of us. My biggest commitment is to me. And so by the very nature of that, I will tend to use you to search for whatever you is out there in whatever context that will give me the greatest pleasure, because that's what I'm about. And if you stop giving me pleasure, I'm out of there. Because that's what it's about for me. It's shrunk down to that size. Now, lest you misunderstand what I'm saying, I think pleasure is a wonderful thing. I mean, God has designed a physical world of glorious pleasure. It's a world of sight, sound, touch, taste, feel, pleasure everywhere. Every day you experience the beauty of those pleasures. I love those pleasures. I mean, the smell of a great steak. Somebody said amen. It'll be very sad if that's the only amen I get. The tenderness of a kiss on your lips. The cold of rain hitting against your face. How amazing is that? The beauty of a sunset. I mean, the endless variety of the shape of human bodies. I mean, look around at the noses in this room. Just do it. I know it's weird, but do it. I mean, how many billion models has God, I mean, how many billion noses has God made and he hasn't yet repeated a model? And your nose matches the particular architecture of your face. Although, in our culture, we don't think that. We're nose freaked out for some reason. I don't get that. And your nose is amazing engineering. Could you imagine if your nose was upside down? Not only would that look weird, you couldn't go out in the rain. And what if your nose was here? It'd be very weird. And it'd be way too close to your armpit. I mean, you don't have to go any closer than the end of your nose to see the glory of God and just what an amazingly pleasurable world this is. Think about the fact that the voice of every human being has a different timbre. Everyone. How many people can call you on the phone and you immediately know who it is by the unique timbre of their voice? Imagine that you can eat an egg. There's a great line, you may not ever remember this this program, but it was a 70s program. Archie Bunker, All in the Family, said once, his wife tried to make him beef tongue, and he said, "I don't want anything that comes out of the mouth of a cow. Give me an egg." But, I mean, you can actually scramble this embryo. And you like it. I mean, they can put bubbles in water, and somehow we enjoy that. I mean, just the variety is endless. Water freezes, and you can skate on it. How weird is that? So we should never be anti-pleasure. Pleasure glorifies God. God created a world of glorious pleasure, and he gave you the capacity to experience it. You should never feel guilty with that. But pleasure has to have boundaries, or it gets dark and destructive and dysfunctional. You may like to eat, but you can't eat 24 hours a day and not die. Maybe you'll smile in your tomb, but you'll be dead. You just can't, you can't have pleasure that doesn't have boundaries. And so it's actually not safe for me to shrink something like sexuality down to the small confines of my wants, my needs, my feelings, because what's often good to me isn't good. And pleasure sought in the wrong way and sought to the wrong degree actually quits being beautiful and becomes dark and destructive and harmful. And here's the problem. We live in a culture that says this: if you apply rules to sex, sex gets destroyed in the process. That sexual freedom requires my independence. You can't tell me what to do here. You can't tell me what to do. You have no right to put your imperative on me. We've shrunk it down to the claustrophobic confines of the individual. The individual must rule this area. And that can never, ever, ever work because you weren't designed with the capability of pulling off autonomy and self-sufficiency. You just weren't. And here's what this means. This will be hard for some of you to accept. You simply aren't smarter than God. Give it up. You're just not smarter than God. If you sit here this evening and in any area of your life, you're telling yourself that you're smarter than God, first, you're a deeply delusional human being. And second, you're starting down a pathway that won't go anywhere good. Because we're not. We were created for dependency. We're not autonomous, and we're not self-sufficient. And if you want to escape the insanity of this culture in the area of sexuality, you have to let go of the thought that maybe in this area I know more than God does. Maybe that means for you, it doesn't make any sense to me that God says, I'm single and I can't be having sex. And it's very tempting because you can't make all the connections to tell yourself, maybe I'm smarter than God. Maybe I know more. Why does this thing have to be restricted to marriage? Maybe that doesn't make any sense to me at all. And when I do that, I'm actually assigning to myself capabilities I don't have. I want to say one other thing about this. If you look at life from biblical perspective, you would never conclude that submission to authority crushes freedom. And thereby authority is a negative thing. What you would have to conclude is submission to authority brings freedom. Because that's the way that I was created to live. That's the level of capabilities that have been hardwired into me by a God who's the ultimate definition of what is wise. So where does that leave us? Well, I want to say it this way. I want to contrast that small picture sex that isolates sex from the huge issues of life, identity, meaning, and purpose, whatever is ultimate, that individualizes sex down to my wants, my needs, my feelings. Contrast that with what I call big picture sex. Sex that is connected to the huge, big, inescapable issues of life. And I want to do that by three statements, and I'll explain each of these. Here's the first one. If sex is about worship, it can't be just about you. Let me say that again. If sex is about worship, it can't be just about you. Now, you're saying, Paul, I'm confused. What in the world does this word worship have to do with sex? And so I need to talk with you about this word. Maybe a lot of you, when you hear the word worship, you think Sunday morning or if it's a cool church Saturday night. Usually it's about a 5 o'clock service on Saturday night, gets out at 6:30, so I really don't have to give up my Saturday, and I got my whole Sunday. That's a God I can worship. That was a cynical joke for those of you who didn't get it. Obviously not a good one. Well, here's what you need to understand. Sex. Worship is first your identity before it's ever your activity. Worship is first your identity before it's ever your activity. You don't just worship on Sunday. You actually worship your way through every moment of every day. In fact, you could argue that the only thing a human being ever does is worship. Now, what does that mean? It means you're always attaching your identity, you're always attaching your meaning and purpose, you're always attaching your inner sense of well-being to something. And there's really only two choices there. You attach your ultimate sense of who you are and what you're meant to do to God, the Creator, or you attach it to something in the creation. And so you have to say that sex is itself an act of worship. In any kind of sexual activity, in any kind of sexual expression, you're in worship of something. You're either worshiping the pleasure of the moment, and that's all you care about, and you're trying to find things there in that experience, or you're worshiping yourself, and all you care about at that moment is your pleasure, and you'll do anything you can in that moment to seduce that other person into being an object for your pleasure. But sex is always an act of worship. You're always worshiping something at that moment. And the way God has designed it is that the ultimate motivation for everything I do in life, even in the most intimate of human experiences, would be the pleasure of God, would be the glory of God, would be the honor of God, would acknowledge that I was made by Him and I was made for Him, and I even express this in this most private, most intimate, most vulnerable of human experiences. And actually, I'm not asking sex to give me what sex will never give me. Because if I'm worshiping God there, then I'm getting my identity, I'm getting my meaning and purpose, I'm getting my inner sense of well-being from God. I don't try to get it from sex. I think one of the reasons we're crazy in our culture is we're asking sex to give us what sex was never meant to give us. Those things we're meant to get vertically, we're seeking horizontally. Sex is not supposed to give you identity. You're not supposed to feel okay about yourself because of sex. I had a lady once in counseling say to me, I've probably had sexual relationships with 100 men, and she said, all I was looking for is for a man to accept me and whisper in my ear, I love you, because that made me feel alive. How dangerous is that? How dangerous is it is to ask something of like sexuality to give you a sense of identity? Or sex gets connected to power. Sex should not be the way that you find power. Maybe that's what rape is about. It's probably not about sex as much as it's about anger and power and dominance. You're looking for something there that was you're not supposed to find there. Sex as an escape or a refuge. It's a way that I deal with the disappointment and the hardness of life. I've counseled many, many, many men who struggled with internet pornography. And one of the themes that they would say to me, on my hardest, most disappointed days, was a time where I was most susceptible to that temptation. Why? Because they're asking for sex to be an escape, to be a healer, to be a comforter. It's very, very dangerous. And so what we do is we actually ask sex to be our own personal Messiah, to give us things that we can't, that it's not meant to give. Sex is not supposed to give you satisfaction of heart, because the buzz of sexuality doesn't last very long. And if you ask for it to satisfy your heart, you'll go back again and again and again and again, and before long, you're hopelessly addicted. And so that if sex is about worship, it has to be about things profoundly bigger than me. Here's a second statement. If sex is about relationship, it's got to be, it's not just about you. If sex is about relationship, it's not just about you. If the first point was the first great command, this is the second great command. Sex, by its very nature, is an act of relationship. In its first created context in Genesis 2, it's put in the context of a long-term committed relationship between a man and a woman. That's where it's supposed to be. It's an act of relationship. And so I can't just be motivated by the small confines of my particular definition of pleasure, because I'm called by God to a moral commitment of self-sacrificing love of neighbor. I'm called to love my neighbor as I love myself. And so that structures the way I think about my sexual life. It's got to be an act of self-sacrificing love. Or if I shrink it to the size of my wants, my needs, my feelings, here's what I do. I reduce the people that I'm interested in, no longer are they objects of my affection. They get reduced to being vehicles or obstacles. I actually dehumanize them. If you're a vehicle helping me get what I want, I'm thankful that you're in my life and I'm going to treat you kindly. But if you're in the way of what I want, you're out of there. There's no commitment. There's no concern about your welfare, because what drives me is my pleasure. If sex is an act of relationship, it can't just be about you. And it is. And third statement, if sex is about obedience, it can't just be about you. You see, I'm not ultimate in my world. There is a God who created me. He carefully designed me. And He knows exactly what is best for me. He's put every aspect of my being together. And He calls me to obey. What is obedience? Well, this is the way my brother Ted talks about it. It's a willing submission of my heart to the authority that God has put in my life that causes me to do what I'm told without excuse, without complaint, and without shifting the blame. You see, obedience is not just about your body. Obedience is a submission of your heart to the God who made you. That's the bottom line of your sexuality. As a sexual being, here's the issue: what will you surrender your heart to? Who or what will own your heart? Because the body will go where the heart has already gone. That's how it works. The body will go where the heart has already gone. The crucial decisions are not first what you'll do with your body. The crucial decisions are what you will surrender your heart to. Because what you give your heart to will ultimately control the way your body is invested. Now, I'm going to give you an opportunity to ask questions. But I want to end by this. I think it's very, very important that we blow up the shroud of silence over this area. I think we need to talk. What I've done is try to just give you a bit of a worldview, because I know you're going to ask me the more practical questions. So we need to blow up the silence. But the other thing we need to say is there's no one in this room that needs to live in shame. There's no one in this room that needs to live in fear. There's no one in this room that needs to hide in guilt. I don't know where you are in this area. But what the gospel of Jesus Christ does is allow us to be the most honest community on earth. We should be the most honest community on earth. Because I don't know if you thought about this or not, but as Jesus hung on the cross, the most significant moment of suffering for Jesus wasn't physical. It was relational. It was that moment when the Father turned his back on the Son. And Jesus cries out, hanging on the cross, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani? My God, why have you forsaken me?" Here's the gospel. Jesus was willing to take the Father's rejection so that on your worst, lost, most rebellious day, you would never see the back of God's head. That's why we can have this conversation. We don't have to sit on our questions. We don't have to feel stupid because we don't understand. We don't have to run away in guilt because we've done things that we may be ashamed of. You can run into the light because there's nothing that could ever be exposed about you that hasn't already been covered by the blood of Jesus. We can be an honest community. And too long has this area that is so wired into your being been shrouded by embarrassment and silence. It's time for us to be honest. And I'm here, not because I lack things to do, but if I could be part of edging this community toward a long-term conversation, toward more openness, toward more honesty, then I would be very grateful for that. Okay, questions. I'll have the answer for every question. It may be, I don't know.
So.
I love a question that begins with so.
So. I've had a couple different thoughts as you've been talking, and the first thing I started thinking about, even when you first started, my heart started to hurt, and I couldn't really explain why, and I still don't exactly understand. But I've been feeling this pain and these struggles for so long, it seems, and it's not that I don't want it to change. I've been trying and trying and trying, but I keep finding myself with the same kind of motivations of pleasure, and my question is, how do I surrender my heart to God? How do I do that? Because I know I've been told time and time again, you just have to give it all up to God, and you can't do anything yourself, but I still feel like, is there a way to ask God that? Like, I still feel like there's some sort of action I need to take, but I just don't know what to do.
Let me say a couple things. I hope these don't frustrate you. It's a wonderful question, and I want to say you've got courage in asking it publicly. I have a tremendous respect for that. I really do. Here's what is important to understand. If my striving and striving harder and striving harder had the power alone to change me, Jesus wouldn't have had to come. The message of the Bible would be, it would only have one phrase, just said 66 times, strive harder, get a grip. So there's something, I get why we want to do that, because we want to grab a hold of something, we want to pick ourselves up the bootstraps, we want to say, tomorrow I'll do better. And maybe you do better for 2 days, and then you're right back there again. Puritans used to talk about importunity, poverty of soul, poverty of heart. Blessed are the poor in spirit. There's something about saying, just crying out to God and not crying to God, I can't do this. I can't do this. Because think about this. I can run from a location. I can run from a situation. I can run from a relationship, but I can't run from me. Whenever I try to run from me, I show up with me at the end of the run. It doesn't work. I mean, it's sort of like the guy who says, puts his computer away and says, I'm never going to look at my computer and lust after those women again, and goes outside and sees a beautiful woman and lust. And he just wants to shoot himself. So I'll tell you what I do. I would like to say that Paul Tripp is a grace graduate and has been for years free of sexual temptation. But it'd be a lie. And so I get up every morning, I pray three prayers. First one is a confession. God, I'm a man in desperate need of help today. That confession is important. It's important for me to confess that. It's important for me to hear myself say that. Second prayer is, I pray that you would send your helpers my way. God, I need help. Whether that's something in the Word of God, maybe that's a song that I hear. Maybe it's the song of a bird, and I remember there is a Creator who is my Savior. Maybe that's someone God sends my way. Send your helpers my way today. I need help. By the way, everything we're talking about today is a community project. We need one another. I can be so incredibly blind. I can be so incredibly full of myself. And I need people in my life. A third prayer is, and oh Lord, please give me the humility to receive the help when it comes. People try to help me, and what do? Rather than being thankful, I excite my inner lawyer, I defend myself, I let them know that I'm not the only sinner in the room. I have a list. And I don't want to admit that I've helped. That's why I have such respect for what you're doing here. Because I imagine there's a whole bunch of other people in the room in the same situation. The other thing I would say is, who do you know that can be your confidant? Someone who's mature, further along than you are, who you can go to. And in moments when you're confused or disappointed or defeated, that they can maybe unpack your experience better than you would be able to do for yourself. Let me say one other thing. By biblical definition, change is most often a process and not an event. My question is, for me, not if I reached ultimate purity, but am I on the road toward that in my life? Do I have things in place that will eventually bear that fruit?
Thank you. My question has to do with the dialogue over sexuality. You emphasized earlier in your talk about the importance of dialogue within the church, but also with the community at large. And you also talked about the centrality of our belief in God in understanding kind of a Christian sexual ethic. Given the centrality of believing in God and understanding kind of a biblical idea of sexuality, how valuable or how possible do you think a dialogue is between Christians and a secular community that doesn't believe in God?
Oh, I think very possible. And you, I don't know if you've realized this or not, but you, mm-hmm. you've made a distinction. Your question, I think, is very important. The way I think about sexuality as a Christian is different from the way I would dialogue with a non-Christian. Let me tell what I mean by that. I think our temptation, it's one of the reasons that I think we've lost a voice in the culture, is we tend to start with the bottom line. We tend to start with the, you can't do this, and this is why. And but that you can't do this, and this is why, is totally out of context. We haven't worked to get a listening. So what I want to do is I don't want to start with my theology. I want to start with that person's experience. I want to affirm their pain. I want to affirm their questions. I want to incarnate the love of the Lord Jesus Christ in that person's life. I want their story to be heard. And what I'm looking for as I'm listening to their story is these entry gates, things that I can begin to get a hold of and say, well, let's talk about that. You make this assumption. Let's talk about that assumption. But you see what's happening now? It's not asking them to come to my ideology, and you must accept my ideology first. I'm actually moving toward their experience, and out of their experience, beginning to have this conversation. Isn't that exactly what Jesus did? He entered human experience, he pointed to things familiar to people's experience, and drew out of them where he needed to go. Here's another thing. I think the tendency for us is to discount the power of people's experience because we think the pain that they feel is based on things that are not true. Does that make sense to you? Mm-hmm. But pain is pain. I gave this illustration to some people who had lunch with me, that let's pretend that I'm in bed one night. My three-year-old child is down the hall, and begins to cry hysterically because he thinks there are monster spiders on the wall. Okay, you got the scene? I don't go into the room as he's screaming and stand in the dark and lecture him at the impossibility and the irrationality of monster spiders. Get a grip. I mean, if you saw me do that, you would think I was the most horrific father ever. And if you were my child, you would soon learn, don't ever expose your pain to this man. This is a cold-hearted man. What do I immediately do? I run into the room, I pick him up, and I hold him. Because although the pain is based on a delusion, it's real pain. He's really afraid. He needs to be comforted. That's entering into his experience. And then what I do is I flip on the lights, and I show him that it was just the moon shining through the trees that put the shadow on the wall, that monster spiders don't actually exist. But now he's predisposed to listen because I've affirmed his experience. I've met him at his point of pain. There it is. I mean, if you have two people on the street and you have to say hard things to both of them, and one knows that you love them and one doesn't know you at all, who is predisposed to listen to you? So Let me say it this way. Our internal dialogue has to be different than our external dialogue. If you're with a group of people who have your theological assumptions, you can start there. But if you're with people that don't, you have to start with their experience, affirm the pieces of your experience that they can, and unpack their experience in ways that give you opportunities.
Thank you.
It's really hard to start a question without saying so, by the way.
So?
Let's say, so.
That's okay.
I told you. I find that one of the most difficult questions a single is asked is, what if you would meet somebody that you like and you find out that they've lost their virginity before they got married? And I know that, that can be something like, wow, you know, that's so evil. And I don't have that mindset, but I find like it's easy to say, oh, well, if God forgives them, I'll forgive them. It's kind of like that answer you give to kind of shrug off that topic of discussion. But what has to be dealt with when somebody does encounter that kind of relationship, I guess, from the person that did have sex before marriage and for the person that did not have sex before marriage?
Well, I mean, you've said it in your own way. I surely want to offer that person the same grace that I've received. But when you marry somebody, you don't just marry that moment. You marry the entire history of that person. You marry all the ways they think about life. You marry all the influences in their life. You marry all the functional distortions of their life. And that's why I think that in this honest community that the Christian community should be, we want to unpack that experience. What is the legacy of all that sexual activity? What does it mean for that person right now? What are the artifacts of that that person is dragging into this marriage relationship? I'm not going to do that in a hurtful, judgmental way. But what you bring into this marriage is going to form what this relationship is about. And it's only in the context of remarkable, amazing grace that you can have that conversation. Because I'm not having that conversation to indict you. I'm not having that conversation to judge you. I'm having that conversation so we can understand one another better. And in the area of our sexual life and marriage, have one of unity and understanding and love. Now, I think because those conversations are hard to have, couples don't actually have them. And they enter marriage with unrealistic expectations. And it doesn't take long for that to become accusations of one another and judgments of love, and it just becomes a mess.
Thank you.
Yeah.
My question is this. There's a history of apprehension as it relates to discussing sex, which continually seems to view sex as a topic that should only be discussed by either husbands and wives or parents and children, specifically in Christianity. In light of the history within Christianity that seems to view sexuality as such, what are some specific strategies that the church and our Wheaton community should take and change in an attempt to change this, and what specifically should we discuss?
Well, I guess I gave myself away near the end, where I said my hope is that I'm part of initiating a community conversation. I think this area, like every other area in my life is a community project. I need to be talking to people. We need to have a conversation, and that can be done responsibly and wholesomely, but it needs to be done. I may be totally unaware of pockets of distortion that are in my thinking as I think about sex. I may be totally unaware of personal areas of blindness, areas of ignorance. And the subject of sex is not itself something that we should be ashamed about. This is a God-created, God-glorifying, wholesome thing. Sex isn't bad by God's design. So we should have the conversation. We need to be thinking about this area. And does it need to be guided? Does it need to be informed? Do we need to be careful? Of course, we do that in any conversation we're having. I do think the church needs to talk about this more. I do think it's crazy that a Christian family would think in an area of this kind of significance, because it's just wired into my being, an area where the culture has gone crazy, that a father can have one 12-minute conversation with his son and never talk about it again and call that preparation. That's insanity. But that's often what happens. I'm glad I had it. Don't you ever talk to me about this again. And don't tell me what you're doing because it would cause me too much grief. Well, that can't work. I'll tell you what I did, because I wanted to dispel that. I took, because they were beginning to ask questions, my 9-year-old and 11-year-old son out for pizza. I got an extra napkin, and I began drawing pictures. These two boys were going. And I said, we don't have to be ashamed. I did that with sort of malice aforethought. And they relaxed, and we began to have this conversation. And I said to them, this is not the last time we're going to talk about this. Because the struggles of an 11-year-old boy are different than the struggles of a 15-year-old boy, are different than the struggles of a 17-year-old boy, are different than the struggles of a 19-year-old boy. And I wanted to think, this guy who is my dad is okay talking about this. No, I really wasn't. I was totally embarrassed and freaked out. And I burned that napkin. But would anybody argue that an issue of this kind of substance is best left in silence? I don't think so. Yeah.
Thank you. Follow-up question. Sex is a really large topic. It encompasses an awful lot. What do you think should be some of the foundational things of what is discussed? And you've talked about, like, yes, we need to start talking about this. But where do we start? What's your recommendation?
Well, I think it's hard for me to answer that question because it really is, the answer would be quite individual. But I would think you start with the question, how am I thinking my way through this? Let's talk about it. How have you made your way? If you had to write, this is my particular view of this area. Second question, where do I tend to struggle with the whole area of my own sexuality? Third question, how am I relating to the noise of the culture? So, what is my basic thinking about this? How have I tried to make sense out of this area? What's my own personal struggle when it comes to this area? How am I relating to the noise of the culture? Maybe a fourth area. And I think this is important. Where does what God calls me to not make sense to me? We shouldn't be afraid to ask that question. I think running to God with those kind of distress questions is an act of faith. Because I'm not running from him, I'm running to him.
Thank you.
Hi, okay. I guess I was just wondering if you could speak to, and I don't think I'm alone in this, those of us in here who are single, I'm not alone in that. Are single and like hearts are in a good place, but to put it bluntly, like just have a lot of sexual energy. And I mean, you said that where your heart goes, your body will go also. And I totally 100% agree with that, but that's very insightful. But what would you say to like the people who, well, I'll just speak for myself and assume other people can relate to this, to like that I have very strong convictions, you know, that I have very like my heart's in a good place when it comes to the topic of sex, but my body's just like, what? So. Also, sorry, I was really close to the microphone for most of the time I was asking that question, so.
Okay.
Yeah, well, can you just speak to that, I guess?
Sure. What I need to say, just so you know, marriage won't solve that. Because my heart's in a good place, but occasionally my body says, what? I mean, it does. That's always the issue. I'm never this side of eternity in a place where there aren't seductive kinds of temptations that I'm facing. And I think one of the inappropriate ways that people think is they think, I've got all this sexual energy that just seems like so troubling to me. If I can just get married, all of that will be solved. It won't. Because we have a perverse desire to fixate on what we don't have. I mean, why does the cookie that I wasn't supposed to take that I snuck taste better than any other cookie? That's just part of the sin that's inside of us. Here's what I think is going on, though, is yes, you're a sexual being, and there's a way in which you can't escape that, and you're going to have sexual interest and sexual desire. So what you should be doing now is preparing yourself for that moment, if it's in God's plan, where you'll be able to express that. And trust that He knows who you are and He knows what you're facing. My belief is this, that God never calls you to something without enabling you to do it. If He puts a Red Sea in front of you and He means for you to cross it, He's going to send a boat, He's going to build a bridge, He's going to give you the ability to swim, or He's going to part the waters. I'm ever, always in a place where I'm desiring things that are outside of God's plan for me. Anybody here? Anybody here free of that? Nobody is. That's not just an issue of singleness. That's an issue of living between the already and the not yet. Over the last couple of years, I've lost a whole lot of weight. The way you gain weight is if you gain a half a pound a year, or a half a pound a month, you'll never notice it. But that's 6 pounds a year, and 5 years, you've taken on more weight. And I had to confess to the sin of gluttony, that I was just consistently eating more than I'm supposed to eat. And it was leading to ill health. That's just one of 50 of those areas in my life that I still grapple with. So what I'm trying to say is I don't think the single person with their sexuality is in a unique position from everybody this side of eternity. We're all attracted to things that are forbidden, and we all have to find the grace of God to stay true to what He's called us to. That's all of us. And I've been married now for 41 years. I know you're looking at me and thinking I'm way too young to be married that long. So if you're trying to calculate my age, I was married at 7. But I can tell you that a long term, I mean, I really do have a wonderful marriage because I married up. I married somebody of dramatically more character than I have. But it hasn't solved those problems for me. I will confess this. There are times in this area where I think, will I ever be free? And for that, we have the grace of Jesus. Maybe one more question. You can choose who's...
And you look great, by the way.
I guess I'll go. That's really loud. So, I promised myself I wasn't going to begin with so, and I did. I was at the airport coming back from spring break, and every time I'm at the airport, I like to go into Hudson News to go read Guitar Player magazine. And you go in there, and there are tons of magazine. Right now, the Sports Illustrated Swimsuit Edition is out, and you know, you've got Maxim. You've got all these magazines that have these unrealistic images of this certain type of, quote, beautiful woman who has these certain features, a certain kind of face, these massive breasts, these different things. And I think most of us in here would agree that these sort of images are wrong. They're presented as normative when they're not. They're not realistic. My question is, what can we do to present an alternative of real beauty, of, you know, real masculine and feminine beauty as something to replace that, as opposed to just trying to shut that down and not having anything to put in its place?
Wonderful question. When I'm in the airport and I like to read food magazines. I can't eat the stuff, so pictures help. I guess it's a form of food lust. I need to pray. I just thought of that. You know what I think about, I see those just sadly objectified images of women. I think, what happened to the stinking women's movement? Is this the legacy? That we are more objectifying women than ever before? Do I need a virtually naked woman to get me to buy a car? Really? And so I think one of the things that needs to happen is there needs to be a generation of women that raise up and say, enough. You'll respect me for my brain. You'll respect me for my accomplishments. You'll respect me for my character. You will not do this to me. Ladies, I plead with you, stand up, get active. Because it's crazy out there. And guys, you ought to be part of that movement. You ought to be angry when the person next to you represents a class of human beings that is so totally objectified. That the height of a woman's career would be showing her breast on the front of a sport magazine. We've gone crazy. And I think what's happened is we've succumbed to the culture. Where is the sanity? It's only going to come from the Church of Jesus Christ. It's the only place it's going to come from. We should be active. We're not going to change everybody's mind, but it's a mission of mercy. Our culture needs it. And we've just removed ourselves from the conversation in reticence and embarrassment. Where are our voices? And don't allow yourself to feel powerless. Don't allow yourself to feel like you have no voice. Don't allow yourself to feel like you cannot make a difference. Stand up. Be bold. Speak against the currents of a culture that demonstrates its insanity all the time. Luella, my wife, loves American Idol. And a couple weeks ago, the outfits that the two female judges were wearing were absolutely ridiculous. There we are. And it's only when this world is connected to these huge issues that we've talked about tonight that you can find any sanity. And the surrounding culture has opted for this individualization of sexuality, my wants, my needs, my feelings, and it only leads to insanity. It's going to come from us. Now, I wouldn't suggest that you go into Hudson and rip down all the magazines and step on them, because they'll probably put you away. But that should rile you up. It should not be okay for us. And in whatever circle of influence you live in, exercise influence. Well, thank you. God bless.